government officials and all our speakers who have contributed towards the socio-educational cause of Famdi community. It's my pleasure to release the flyer of our next webinar, which is on 18th of July, 2021. The timing is 5 p.m. and the topic is deep vein thrombosis and pulmonary embolism. Kindly register for the same if you're interested in it. I'm thankful to our speaker for today, Dr. Bindu Menon ma'am, who is also conducting this whole course for us. I would like to hand over the session to Vaishnavi, my teammate, who will be introducing Bindu ma'am. Over to you, Vaishnavi.
Thank you so much, Aishwarya. I once again welcome all our participants for this lecture. I'm glad to introduce our speaker, Dr. Bindu Menon ma'am. This is a very brief introduction, as we all know, ma'am. Dr. Bindu Menon ma'am is a senior consultant neurologist at Apollo Speciality Hospitals, Nellore, Andhra Pradesh. Ma'am has done MD in medicine, DM in neurology, DNB neurology, PGDCN neurology from London, FRCP from Edinburgh, MNAMS, FICP, FIAN, FWSO. Ma'am has also founded the Dr. Bindu Menon Foundation in August 2013. She has been instrumental in starting novel projects for the first time in the country, Neurology on Wheels, mobile application, epilepsy app called as Epilepsy Help for epilepsy patients, tele-awareness program, and stroke rehabilitation app for stroke help. With this very brief introduction, I'd like to hand over the session to ma'am. Over to you, ma'am.
Thank you very much, Aishwarya and the whole team. And I think congratulations, you people have been featured on the Atmanirbhar Bharat, which is really a good feat for you and for all the work that you are doing. Can you see my slide?
Yes, ma'am, the slide is visible, ma'am.
So as Aishwarya had earlier mentioned, that this talk is basically featured only on the clinical aspects and the examination part and not on the clinical manifestations and diagnostic. And as we move forward in our lecture series, we will definitely take up, but it is also very important to know, because all of you would be gradually be posted in the outpatients, in the inpatients, as well as in the ICU setup. So basic neurological examination would always be mandatory so that you know what you're dealing with when you are dealing with the patient. So we're going to do the cranial nerves. As you can see, there are 12 cranial nerves. And as we write it on paper, it has to be always in the Roman numericals as it has been depicted here. And you never write it as 1, 2, 3, 4, and is always depicted in this way. And the area from where the cranial nerve emerges gives us an idea of the localization of the lesion of the patient. In fact, if the patient has got a cranial nerve examination done, and has got any other deficit in the body, the multiple areas which come together help us in diagnosing where the lesion remains. So as I have pointed out in this slide, you can see that we have the cranial nerve names here, which is olfactory, optic, oculomotor, trochlear, trigeminal, abducens, facial, vestibulocochlear, glossopharyngeal, vagus, the spinal accessory, and the hypoglossal. Out of which, the areas from where the cranial nerves emerges is the first and the second is from the cortical. The third and the fourth, that is the oculomotor and the trochlear, is from the midbrain. The fifth, sixth, seventh, and eighth is from the pons. And the rest are from the medulla. So to speak in simple terms, if the patient has got a hypoglossal or he has got a glossopharyngeal, he has got a swallowing deficit, we say that it is from the lower cranial nerves. So we know that it is somewhere in the brainstem. If the patient has got a vision deficit, we know that we are dealing with something which is high cortical. if the patient has got eye movement abnormalities, has got some facial sensation, we know that it is in the brainstem, which is pertaining to the midbrain and the pons. So a localization helps us to localize the lesion as well. And then the etiological localization is also very easy. So if a patient comes with a fever and comes with a lower cranial nerve involvement, then we know that probably the patient would be having some form of basal meningitis, which is involving all the lower cranial nerves. So the cranial nerves always exit out of the skull foramina, and it is very important because certain lesion can be at the foramen itself when they are emerging out. And this is just a pictorial representation. I would just want you to have a glance at them, and I would not go into the anatomical details of how it is. Now, the cranial nerves have three predominant functions. They could be either sensory, they could be motor, or they could be mixed, of which we have pure sensory, that is olfactory, optic, and auditory. So the name itself, we know olfactory is for smell, optic is for vision, auditory is for hearing. So they're pure sensory. They do not have any motor testing. So we know that what when we have tested this, we have tested and completed the cranial nerve examination for that particular nerve. Then they have we have pure motor, which does not have any sensory element to it, which is trochlear, the abducens, the accessory, and the hypoglossal. Then there are the mixed nerves, which are very difficult for us to examine because they have multitude of examination which needs to be done. That is the fifth, the seventh, the glossopharyngeal, the vagus, and the oculomotor. So we will take them in turns and we will go. So when we are looking at an abnormality in the cranial nerve, what we are seeing is whether there is a cranial nerve dysfunction. Then we want to know what is the nature of the cranial nerve dysfunction. Where is the extent of the abnormality? Extent of the abnormality means, is the patient having only one single cranial nerve abnormality, or he has got multiple cranial nerve involvement. Then we look at any associated features along with the cranial nerve involvement. Say, for example, if the patient has got a vision abnormality, along with it, the patient has got paraparesis. So we feel that there are two areas in the central nervous system as well as in the spinal cord which is involved. So what is the type of lesion, etiological lesion, which we are looking at, whether it could be demyelination, or in some cases, whether it could be some infective pathology which has got in the optic nerve as well as in the spinal cord. So associated lesions along with that, which helps us to classify and tell us the etiological diagnosis as well. Any cranial nerve abnormality can be from the central nervous system. That is, it could be cortical, it could be from the thalamus, the cerebellum, or parts of the brainstem, as we saw the pons, midbrain, and the medulla. Or it could be in the nucleus itself, from the nucleus where it originates, or from the nucleus the nerve has emerged out. It could be only that nerve particular is involved. Or when you're looking at the patient, you could have patient, you may feel that the patient has got a third nerve abnormality, but are we looking at a generalized problem for the patient? That is, the patient, whether he has got a myopathy, that he has got a muscle disease, or whether he has got a neuromuscular junction abnormality, that is, he has got a myasthenia or a Leighton-Ambert syndrome, or he has got a botulism, or he has got a generalized disease like Guillain-Barré syndrome, that is an AIDP. So you may be probably looking at one cranial nerve at that point of time. Let me say that patient has got a bilateral facial weakness, but then it could be from the neuromuscular junction, he could be having a myasthenia, or it could be a GB syndrome. That's the reason he has got a bilateral facial, but that one particular bilateral facial will not be helping you to make a diagnosis, because then you need to see the patient in total. And that's where the associated findings along with the cranial nerve help you. There could be more than one cranial nerve which could be abnormal, and then that helps us in localizing, because we know the anatomy is like a mathematics. If there is a lesion where there are several cranial nerves which run together, which is in the CP angle as we see here, then characteristically the patient comes with a facial weakness and also complains of hearing deficit and complains of mild gait abnormality. So that is at the CP angle. This is the cerebellopontine angle, where there is a facial nerve, there is a vestibular nerve, and the cerebellum also at the CP angle, which is producing the classical triad of symptoms, and we can help to localize. or it could be in the cavernous sinus where we have the oculomotor complex, the trigeminal nerve, and we have the classical proptosis for the patient and the eye movement abnormality. When the patient comes with multiple cranial nerve abnormality, when it can be a generalized, as I said, in myasthenia, or it could be in patients where they have a multi-infarct state. So if you see this patient, if this particular patient, if you see if the patient comes with a difficulty in swallowing, but then you may feel that the patient has got a cranial nerve abnormality, which is a lower motor neuron. So what I mean is that it is in the nerve or in the nucleus per se itself. But when we see the patient, you may understand that the patient has got swallowing deficit, which is a cortical phenomenon, which is bilateral. He has got multiple infarcts here, and that is producing a pseudobulbar palsy. And that is why the patient is not able to swallow. And he has got other features like emotional incontinence. He has got dysphagia. He's got nasal regurgitation. And then when you take the history properly, then you will find that he has got other telltale signs of recurrent strokes in the past. So other associated findings and the other cranial nerves with which the patient, the company which he keeps, that's what we say. You need to diagnose the patient by the company which the patient keeps. The abnormalities of the cranial nerve are also helpful. If the patient has got a nuclei of the cranial nerve within the brainstem, which acts as a marker, you would have heard of something known as a crossed hemiplegia. Usually in a cortical stroke, what the patient has got a facial weakness, that is a facial weakness, that is a upper motor neuron type of facial weakness, that is only the lower part of the face which is involved, and a hemiparesis on the same side. So the one same side is involved and it is a cortical lesion. But if it's the nucleus is involved, that is, let me say it is the pons which is involved. From the pons, the facial nucleus is involved. So where will be the lesion, the facial palsy? It will be on the same side. But because the corticospinal tracts have crossed onto the opposite side, the patient will have a weakness on the opposite side. So one look at the patient, you know, he has got a big facial weakness on one side and a weakness and a hemiparesis on the opposite side. That is a crossed weakness. That is a crossed hemiplegia. The characteristically, the localization immediately goes into the pontine brainstem. Why this is important? Because if the patient comes in that way and you are doing a CT scan for the patient, because of the windowing effect, you will not find a lesion in the CT scan and you would be still be confused at what is the lesion, whether it is an ischemia, infarct or something else which you are missing, and you need to have an MRI which will pick up a brainstem pathology very clearly. So if the cranial nerve affected and then the lesion on the opposite side, this is known as a M. If the tongue and the face are affected on the same side as the hemiplegia, then the lesion must be above the 12th and the 8th cranial nerve. So these are, there are several syndromes which are described in the literature, but then the few ones are the 5th, the 7th, and the 8th, that is a CP angle lesion, the 3rd, 4th, 6th, and the 7th, which is a cavernous sinus lesion, the lower cranial nerve, that is a jugular foramen syndrome. Classically, the patient has difficulty in swallowing and the patient has classically tongue atrophy on that side, but doesn't have any limb atrophy. So mind you, that doesn't have any limb atrophy. So it's only in the foramen where only the nerves, the cranial nerves have been involved. So it is not involving the corticospinal tract. That means it has not gone into the brainstem. It is still in the jugular foramen. That's the classical way it presents. And these will be usually unilateral. If they're very unilateral, you need to go at that site where either it is exiting out of the foramen or it is in the nucleus itself, or it is in that angle where the nerves are emerging out. But if it is more bilateral, if it is a lower motor neuron, as I said, it could be a bulbar palsy. You can have patients presenting with motor neuron disease. You would have seen the lower cranial nerves getting involved. It is more of a generalized disease where the anterior hand cells of the particular cranial nerves are involved, or it could be a pseudobulbar palsy, as I said, in which the patient will have emotional incontinence, patient will have spasticity, patient will have other features of stroke or multiple sclerosis or any other deficit which has produced multiple cortical areas of the brain which are involved. As I mentioned, they could be basal meningitis, chronic infective or inflammatory. So now we go to only the salient features of each particular cranial nerve. The first cranial nerve, the least examined cranial nerve. But then if a DM student doesn't examine the first cranial nerve, then his chances of passing in the examination becomes very bleak. That is to emphasize that each cranial nerve is important And then with clinical acumen, you may decide which cranial nerve you need to examine in a 5-minute outpatient consultation. So olfactory is a sense of smell. It is the shortest cranial nerve. It passes through the cribriform plate, and this is a cribriform plate. You can see, as we mentioned, it has got only one function, that is sensory. It doesn't have a motor and a parasympathetic function here. The important causes of a cranial nerve dysfunction, by we should know, one is by a history. You ask whether the patient has a change in smell. And at this COVID-19 era, all of us know that cranial nerve one attained a lot of importance. And that was one of the first sign of the patient getting infected by the virus per se. Then a casual testing, formal testing is that you just pick out some objects which are present in next to you. Initially used to be the perfumed erasers, which we used to carry in our pocket to make them smell, whether they can understand that there is a smell change. Then you ask the patient to close the eyes and to close one of the nostril and put each type of object in front of the one nostril and asking him or her to recognize the smell. There can be three answers you can get when the patient is, they may definitely not come out with an answer. The people who can recognize and name odors quickly, it's usually said that the female gender can do that. Who can recognize, but there is a difficulty in naming. Usually the male genders, we find that they cannot. Who can smell and know difference, but neither recognize nor naming, and that's that becomes a pathological thing. It's very important for us to understand that what are the pathology which are in which is important for the first cranial nerve, anosmia, which is the loss of sense of smell. It could be one lesion, reasons of the respiratory tract, rhinosinusitis. So you need to remove them and know that they are not included in the cranial nerve examination anosmia for a neurological examination. The most important is a trauma. So as we had seen here, this is a cribriform plate, which we are seeing here. And if the patient has got a head injury, the cribriform plate is a bony structure. And you can see that the olfactory nerve is coming out of this and it just tends to get crushed. And that produces this anosmia. So if the patient has got a closed injury and the patient complains of a loss of smell, that means there is an internal fracture that could be there for the patient. And that could be probably a long lasting also. And you need to have proper cuts done for that. It's also very important in these settings, because if they have a small fracture at this point in the cribriform plate or the ethmoid bone, later on in their life, they can have something which is known as a CSF rhinorrhea. You would have heard, when patients just bend down, they just have dripping of the CSF because the breach in the skull has happened, and then the CSF comes out. CSF coming out, it can lead to infection and can produce meningitis for the patient. The other ones are chronic meningeal inflammation, and Parkinson's disease is one which produces classical hyposmia early in the stage, but then most of the times it's missed unless in a research setting where we try to find out whether the patient has. The second is a Foster-Kennedy syndrome. You can see this is a frontal lobe, and you can see if a lesion is sitting here and is pressing on the olfactory nerve there, it produces an anosmia for the patient. But apart from that, you can see that the patient's optic nerve can also get compromised here. And the patient has got a characteristic, he will have a optic atrophy on one side and a opposite side, because of the raised intracranial tension, there will be a papilledema. So you understand that a tumor which is sitting here is producing a pressure on the first cranial nerve and producing an anosmia. Producing a pressure on that particular optic nerve and producing an atrophy, because the patient has got a large tumor and producing a generalized raised intracranial tension, producing a papilledema. A classical sign when the patient comes, you can pinpoint and say that this is a Foster-Kennedy syndrome. We come to the second cranial nerve, and a very important cranial nerve, because this is the nerve which gives vision into the brain. That means to say that you can really visualize the cranial nerve. That means you can really see with the ophthalmoscope and you can see what's happening inside the brain. It provides special somatic afferent fibers for vision. It is afferent limb for the pupillary light reflex. And we know that there are two limbs. One is an afferent limb where you shine the torch, I'll come through, and it passes through the optic canal of the skull. So the examination is divided into the four categories. One is a visual acuity, one is a color vision, one is a visual field, that is the field of vision. Whatever space you are seeing in front of you is your visual field, fundus and the optic disc. So visual acuity, we all of us know that we have a far vision and a near vision. Just for briefing, that is the Snellen's chart and the Jagger's chart. That is a 20 feet by 6 feet. The formula is D by large D. D is where is a 6 meter, and D distance is where the patient reads it clearly. And then you make it by 6 by 6 or 20 by 20. Now, this is a formal testing. Most of the times in a neurology outpatient, we don't do that. The patient usually comes with it. But for us to know whether the patient has got a neurological disorder or the patient has got a cataract or got a lens or some sort of opacity which is producing that, you do a pinhole test. So in our residency days, we used to have that cardboard and we used to make a small pin. And we ask the patient to look through that and see if the patient can visualize. So the paper blocks, so this paper will block most of the misaligned light rays, and the patient has got a clear vision. The visual blurring goes off, and the central rays to the focus onto the retina. So if the pinhole makes the patient's vision to improve, then it is a refractory error. Then you can probably be little assured that the patient does not need any more further neurological examination and testing. But if it does not improve, it could be due to an optic nerve pathology, and this is known as a pinhole test. So now there are characteristic instruments which are used by the ophthalmologist, which they utilize in their ophthalmic outpatient department. Then we have the near vision, in which the paragraphs are printed in successive coarser type, is 0 to 7, and the 7 is the biggest. So you do the visual acuity, you've done the far, you've done the near, you've done a pinhole test, and you've found out whether he has a refractive error, he needs to go to the ophthalmologist, or needs to remain to you for further vision. Then you do the color vision. So in a color vision, basically the color vision can be impaired. Apart from the color blindness, again, we are doing only a neurological testing here. Apart from the color blindness, the most common pathology is the optic nerve and the cortical pathology. Last class, if somebody could probably recall, we had told about color agnosia. We had told about visual agnosias, where the patient cannot identify and match colors, though his understanding of the color is good. His vision is good. He can know what color is, but he doesn't know that an apple is red, and he may put, if he's asked to color the apple, he may put this as blue or some other color. And the other pathologies are red color, that is an optic nerve pathology itself, or we usually see it in ethambutol toxicity. The patient is on AKT, then the patient definitely should be asked for color vision. And you can have small colors which are in handy. We used to have a small kit and we used to frequently show it off, so that an early ethambutol toxicity can be recognized and the patient can be taken off that offending tablet. In optic neuritis, apart from the red color, it is also the color hues. You know, color hues is the different shades of color. So you can have a red, you can have a dark red, you can have a light red. The patient cannot appreciate the hues of the color. So if he's asked from here, he cannot differentiate them because the color looks more or less similar. But then if this is asked, then the color is a little different. So he may be able to differentiate the color. So you do the visual acuity finished, you do the color vision finished, and you have seen that there are some pathologies there, and you're trying to narrow down the diagnosis by finding out whether it is in the nerve or it is more of a cortical problem. Then you do the visual field. The visual field, as I said, that it is the area of vision which you can appreciate in front of you. And what is the area which you can appreciate is the degrees which I have mentioned here. Medially, a person can see up to 60 degrees. You cannot see the tip of your nose, you know, so you can see only 60 degrees. Laterally is the maximum you can see, of around 110. Sorry, it's 100 to 110. You can see around 110 degrees. Up and low, you can see around 50 to 60. So apart away from that, your peripheral field and your central field of vision is not there. So how do you test in a patient is in a general outpatient examination is a confrontation test. Your patient is sitting in front of you. You are sitting here. You close the eyes and the patient closes the right eye. You close the left eye and you bring the finger from the periphery to the center. So you bring the finger not from, you make sure that you're placing the largest in the patient, not yours. So if you put it here, you can see it. He cannot see it. So this is the center line. This is the patient. You all are patients at from that period of time. And I am here. And you bring it from here. And assuming that your visual fields are normal. And if you are able to appreciate from that, from the till that area, that means that he should also be. So any defect in the visual field is a scotoma, and a scotoma which is surrounded by a visual field. So this is a crude way of testing, early easy way of testing, faster way to come to a conclusion whether the patient has got any visual field defects, which can narrow down in an outpatient. But then you have got perimetry charting, which can be officially done, and you can see the graph there, and you can find out whether, but that takes time consuming. He has to visit the ophthalmologist. So basically, if you find this is the optic pathway, you have the optic nerve, you have both the optic nerves cross, and that is the optic chiasm. Then you have the optic tract, and then you have the optic radiation, and this is occipital lobe, right? So this is the simplified optic pathway. So if the lesion is before the optic chiasm, then there is a loss of visual field on the same eye, right? It is understandable. If this optic nerve is damaged here, then this eye vision will be lost, right? But if it is at the optic chiasm, you can see that it crosses, maximum crosses, some of them grow uncrossed if it is here. Then the vision field will be a bitemporal hemianopia, because you know that the optic nerve fibers correspond to the temporal side of both the side. So the patient will have a bitemporal hemianopia. That is, he will not be able to see both sides. That is the temporal fields he will not be able to see. If you bring the finger from here, you can ask him to count. So you can ask him to count three. He sees from here. You have started seeing from there. So you are seeing this. He is able to see this much. That is, he's got a tunnel vision. So you can understand if he has got a pituitary lesion here, if he has got any brainstem lesion here, he has got any third ventricular lesion here, which is pressing on the optic chiasm. So he will be able to see only as a tunnel, and his bitemporal hemianopia would be there. Anything after the optic chiasm will be a homonymous hemianopia. Homonymous hemianopia means both fields. That is temporal from here and nasal from here. That is, he is not able to see on this side. He is not able to see on this side. Either it can be left or right, depending upon the opposite side that is involved. Easy to remember, before the optic chiasm, complete loss of vision, visual fields on the same side. At the optic chiasm is bitemporal. After the optic chiasm is a homonymous hemianopia. This would be a more detailed one, in which if the fibers are affected, the patient can have quadrantinopias rather than hemianopia. Hemianopia, as I said, it is this picture as it shows, these gray areas the person can't see, the white areas the person can see. This is a homonymous hemianopia, that is a nasal of one side and the temporal of other side. But then if only the fibers are involved, the patient can't see just this top part, or the patient can't see this inferior part. Why this is important for us is because if the patient is driving and he cannot see the lower quadrant area, and if he has to take a right side turn, and if he's, let us say, if he's a bus driver, he's a professional driver, that is important because he cannot be allowed to drive even though it is a small quadrant of his part. So that in that case, we need proper, especially this happens in patients with the cortical lesions. They need to have proper perimetry testing, and then they need to go to the ophthalmologist and get it in writing whether their visual fields are normal for that particular profession. So this is the last part of the optic nerve is when we have done the visual acuity, the far vision, the near vision, the color vision, the visual field, and then the last is the fundus. This we can see, this is a normal optic disc. This is a ophthalmoscope, visualized the right eye, visualizes the left eye, and this is a blurred disc. We'll not go to the fundus, that's a chapter on its own. Then we come to the pupil, which is crossed between the second and the third nerve. And people who are posted in the intensive care know the importance of a pupil. The pupil has to be equal, bilateral, and reacting normally. The pupil reacting slowly or briskly. The pupil one-sided dilated. It could be a unilateral compressed cranial third nerve. Any dilated which affects the sympathetic has to be a compressive etiology. Bilateral dilated fixed is definitely an ominous sign. It's a sign of a raised ICT. Pinpoint pupils, it could be due to any lesion in the pons, or it could be due to any of the drugs, or sometimes it could be due to metabolic lesion. So in a pupil, we check the light reflex and the accommodation reflex. So let us see what we do. So this is the light reflex. The patient is asked to look at a distant object and you switch on from in front. So if you bring the torch in front like this, he is going to use his accommodation and his pupils are going to constrict. So you need to bring the torch from the further end so that you have completely shielded this eye. This eye is not affected by the light torch here. And also this eye is not affected by the accommodation or the hand which you are bringing in front of him. So it has to be an abrupt stimulus. All of us know that it has to be swing and then go, swing and go. That is, we call it the swinging flashlight test, because we bring from one to the other to see the direct and the consensual reflex. So if I'm allowed to play this video, so if you bring the light shown here, it goes through the optic nerve, chiasm, travels all up to the pretectal nucleus, which is in the midbrain, crosses at the aqueduct, then at the Edinger-Westphal nucleus, and then with the ciliary ganglion, and it constricts the pupil. So the direct response is by the optic nerve, and that is the afferent, and the efferent limb is by the third nerve. So lesions at that point, we should know, one is a direct and a consensual response. What is a direct and a consensual response? This is a normal eye. I shine the torch here. You see that this pupil has constricted. This is a direct response, and this is a consensual response. I shine here. This is a direct response. This is a consensual response. Both response should be equal and normal. So this, both the pupils are normal. That means the afferent limb and the efferent limb, that is the second and the third nerves, are intact. Now we have something known as a RAPD. You would have seen doctors writing out in the prescription forms or in the outpatient or inpatient, that is relative afferent pupillary defect. That is a sign of a optic nerve pathology. So you have this, both the eyes here, the torch is shown in this eye. You can see that this pupil has constricted. That means the second is normal here. This pupil is also constricted. That means the efferent is also okay. You shine the torch here, then you see that this is not constricting. That means that the patient has got a second nerve pathology here. Because the afferent limb is not proper, it is not giving a consensual response, but the eye was constricting very well to light here. That means the optic nerve pathology was normal. So this is, again, that is a positive RAPD. It is very commonly used for us for an early detection of a detection of an optic nerve pathology to know. If there are bilateral optic nerve pathology, then it is very difficult to find out because both eyes would not constrict properly. Then, as I said, one is a light reflex, pupillary light reflex, and second is a pupillary accommodation reflex. You ask the patient to fixate on a distant object. So let us say he is looking at a calendar over there. Then you immediately ask him, put a finger in front of his face and ask him to look at the finger, which is around 10 centimeters from the face. So keep the target high, eyelids will obscure, because if you keep the finger here, then you definitely cannot see the pupil. So clinical examination is very important. You need to keep the finger here so that you can see the pupil of the vision. The eyes should converge and the pupil should constrict. So this is how it is. So if the patient, in this patient, if you, if this is a pathological eye. So you see that the patient's pupils are bilateral meiotic and they are not regular shaped. The patient's pupils are not reacting to light, but the patient's pupils are very bristly reacting to accommodation. A very classical Argyle-Robertson pupil, a stigma of a syphilitic, post-syphilitic sequelae that is known as the AR pupil. So you would have patients who would respond, who would be reacting to light, but not reacting to accommodation, who would be reacting to accommodation, who would not be reacting to light. It helps us again to come to an etiology. So that's the perla, which you would find in the ICU and the emergency, which is very easy for us. That is the acronym, pupils equal, round, reactive to light and accommodation. Now we know that it, how it is important, equal, round, any sort of stigma, infective stigma, reactive to light, whether the optic nerve and the third nerve are intact, accommodation, again, the third nerve is intact. In one sentence, perla, normal, tells us that the cranial nerve, second, third, are intact more or less. We come to the eye movement, that is the third, fourth, sixth. Apart from the pupils, the third has this function, and in which we see for, apart from the eye movements, we also see for the supracortical movement, eye movements, that is a saccadic, pursuit, vestibular, ocular, and the convergence. Why do we say saccadic and pursuit as supracortical? Because they are gaze phenomenon. Gaze means both eyes move together. That is left-sided gaze, right-sided gaze. You would say that right gaze is not proper, left gaze is not proper. That doesn't mean that one eye is not moving. Both eyes move in unison. So saccadic eye movements from the frontal lobe, pursuit from the occipital lobe, VOR from the cerebellar and vestibular, and convergence is from the midbrain. And that is where we have the eye movement panel of cranial nerves, that is the third, fourth, and the sixth. So for us to remember, we will keep it as lateral rectus is sixth, fourth is superior oblique, and all the other movements are three. Easy for us to remember that way. LR6, SO4, and rest all the movements are by the third cranial nerve. What are the abnormalities one can get from the third, fourth, and sixth? Is usually a double vision. That is, the patient might see a double vision in which the patient's the objects are side by side or one above the other, one on tangent to other. So one, how do we check for a double vision? It is checked in this graph, right? That's how we make a graph table on the sheet itself. You keep the pen here, you move on to all the quadrants. Look here, do you see one? Do you see one? Do you see one? Do you see? 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 So you have these nine quadrants and the central to see whether the patient can appreciate the object as one or two. So there are no double vision. Still, the patient has got some abnormality occurs in supranuclear. As I said, anything supranuclear is third, fourth, sixth, we said from the midbrain and pons. Any lesion which is above the midbrain and pons can produce gaze abnormality, but will not produce diplopia. So you would have seen patients with the hemiplegia, they come with eyes onto one side. They will keep looking like this. They will just not look at this side. That is gaze predominance to this side and gaze preference is to one side, but they don't look at one side, but they don't have diplopia. They'll see one because both the gaze on one side have the fibers which go and go into the retina and are focusing the object. But double vision could be if there is a nerve, there is a neuromuscular or the muscle. So if it, there is a double vision, you know that it is a nuclear pathology, that is it from the midbrain or the pons, or it could be from the nerve, or it could be any of the lesion, you know, it could be a neuromuscular junction, it could be a myasthenia, it could be a muscle pathology, it could be a nerve of a diabetic third nerve palsy, any of this can produce. So what are the double vision rules? Is maximal in the direction of the affected site. So if I have a patient who says there is a pen, I can see here, doctor, I can see a pen here, and this pen, if this is here, this is, we know that lateral rectus is a right-sided sixth nerve, and this vision is the abnormal vision, outer image, false image, less glorified, less difficult to see. So that is a lateral rectus. So the false image arises from the affected side. You also need to look at the patient. A classical is the fourth nerve lesion. The superior oblique, they will move because the primary function is an intorsion. They will try to tilt the head so that the image is perceived in the retina properly. You also need to look at the ptosis. If there is a ptosis, you know that there could be a third cranial nerve. So resting position of the eyes and the primary position of the eyes need to be seen. So do they diverge or converge, and do they appear to be looking down a ski deviation? So once we have checked the cranial nerve, third, fourth, sixth for the movements and check whether the patient has got diplopia, check whether the patient's head position, how it is, whether the patient has got any other eye movement which is skewed, divergent or convergent, which can localize into the midbrain and the thalamus. Then we come to the supranuclear eye movements. They are the saccades and the pursuit. Saccade for frontal lobe, you can remember. Pursuit is for occipital lobe. Now we'll understand what is pursuit. Pursuit is simply is that if a person is moving in a room and you're following the person in the room, that's a pursuit. Right? Saccade is if you are sitting in a table tennis court and you see the ball going from here, means you are shifting your gaze from one end to the other, that becomes a saccade. So pursuit movement, how do you check? The diagrammatic representation given here, you can just hold the patient. If needed, you can just hold the patient a little bit because they tend to move their head. You keep the pen around 50 centimeters and ask the patient to follow the pen on all the sides and to see the speed of the movement, whether there is any break in the pursuit, whether there is a smooth movement. So any break in the pursuit movements could suggest a cerebellar lesion and some other signs. So you are checking for a pursuit. You're also checking, when you're checking the pursuit, you're also checking whether there is any cranial nerve abnormality, right? You have checked whether his lateral rectus, the range of the movements are good, and any of the cranial nerve, individual third, fourth, sixth are abnormal. How do you check for the saccade? Saccades are checked by asking the patient to, you sit in front of the patient the way you sat in while you were testing the visual fields. You hold both your hands out in front, which are 30 centimeter apart and 30 centimeters. Ask the patient to look from, look here, look here, look here, look here, look up, look down, look up, look down. So you need to see the range of the movement. You need to see whether they are smooth, whether they are full, whether he's overshooting the saccade. Like in cerebellum, you know, patients have a finger nose ataxia, they overshoot the target. In the same way, are they overshooting their eye target as well? Or whether they are broken saccades or they are very slow saccades, which we see in spinocerebellar ataxia too, or very slow saccades or no saccades, in which we see in extrapyramidal symptoms like progressive supranuclear palsy, especially the vertical ones are gone. Then you ask the patient to check for the convergence. Again, you're sitting in front of the patient, ask the patient to look at a distant object. The way you had checked for the convergence, you ask the patient to look at the finger in front, and you are asking the patient to see, you can see that the left eye is not converging. So there is a lesion sitting there, which is suggestive of a medial rectus. That means it is in the midbrain, that is in the third nerve. So the lesion could be somewhere from the fibers from the third nerve, from the midbrain to the third nerve. The last we check in a supranuclear is a vestibular ocular reflex, who all are posted in the ICU settings or in the emergency settings. When the patient comes, is drowsy and comatose, you want to check whether the patient's brain stem is intact. So it's usually checked in an unconscious patient, but you can check it in a patient while he's in the outpatient also. So in a patient who is unconscious, you can see this is a normal and this is an abnormal one. The general rule is you are asking the patient to look at a fixated different object. Let me say that I am fixating at you people and I am moving my eye here. So if I am moving my eyes, the vestibular ocular reflex, if it is intact, my eye should be fixating at you, but my head can turn on that side. I turn here, I turn here. But in a patient whose vestibular ocular reflex or the doll's eye maneuver is not intact, the patient, when the eyes are moved, his eyes also move that side. This tells us the brainstem, if the brainstem is intact or not. It tells us how bad the patient is, the prognostication of the patient. So you need to go ahead with the caloric testing and see whether the patient has whether the patient is brain dead, you know. So these nerves can be involved, the third, fourth, and sixth, in the pontine lesions, midbrain lesions, neoplasms, strokes, multiple sclerosis, demyelination, meningeal tumors of the base of the skull, raised intracranial pressure, and isolated sixth cranial nerve, head injury patients with multiple cranial nerve palsies, and as I mentioned earlier, cavernous sinus and a carotid aneurysm. Then we come to the fifth cranial nerve. It's the largest and a sensory fiber for the face, motor segment for mastication. It emerges from the pons. It is the afferent limb for the corneal reflex. And the seventh is the efferent limb for the corneal reflex. So we know the light reflex is second and the third, afferent and the efferent. For the corneal reflex, it is the fifth and the seventh, the afferent and the efferent limb. Why it is important? Because again, it helps us in localizing. And it has three divisions, ophthalmic, maxillary, and the mandibular. So these are the divisions. We also understand the most common affected pathology which we see in outpatient is the trigeminal neuralgia, that is compromised with the trigeminal nerve with any of the vessel, produces a severe excruciating pain in one of the divisions. So we need to demarcate whether the patient has gotten the ophthalmic, maxillary, or the mandibular. It goes from the jaw, preauricular, and this area. The next we test, once we have tested for the sensory, you ask the patient to cleanse the teeth and see for the masseter and the temporalis. You are checking at the muscle, the power of the muscle, and you are checking whether the patient's clenched teeth has got the power. And you're also checking at whether the patient has got any wasting, that the patient has got grooves here, and the temporalis also. So long-standing diseases can produce. The patient can have a hollowed out appearance in patients you see in myotonic dystrophy, the hatchet phase, you say, where the lower part of the face is hollowed out. And in patients who have got unilateral lesions, the mandible will deviate towards the paralyzed side. So if the patient has got a fifth cranial nerve mandibular division, which has got affected, so the normal side will push the jaw towards the paralyzed side, right? Otherwise, the jaw would move towards, if the patient is asked to open the mouth, it will be in the center. But if this masseter and the temporalis are paralyzed, this muscle is more powerful, so it will push onto the opposite side. So how do you check the corneal reflex? So I'll go to the next slide. So the corneal reflex is tested by touching on the cornea and not on the conjunctiva. So one should be very careful. Again, you're not supposed to bring a cotton and go and punch him on the face like this, because you are going to produce a Meniere's reflex. The moment you bring like this, he's going to blink his eyes, and you're not going to get a corneal reflex. You're supposed to ask him to open the eyelids properly. You may just warn him that you're going to bring that from the side of the face, and you're going to test the cornea. So once you test the cornea, the afferent limb is a trigeminal nerve. It goes into the pontine center and it goes into the facial nerve, and the facial nerve is responsible for blinking of the eyes. So what you're testing is, what he would be telling, you would be seeing is a blink of the eye, blink of both the eyes. It's not one eye, blink of both the eyes. So this could be involved in tumors, or it could be a cranial meningeal lesion. It could be a trigeminal sensory neuropathy, trigeminal neuralgia, which is an irritative lesion in which the corneal reflex is intact unless and until it is due to some other vasculitic pathology where the nerve itself gets damaged. Otherwise, the sensations are intact in a trigeminal neuralgia. As we said, in an acoustic neuroma, in the CP angle tumor, where you have the 5th, the 7th, and the 8th cranial nerve coming out of the the patient could have a MS or a syringomyelia. Now we come to the most commonly seen nerve pathology in the outpatient, and all of you would have seen at some point in your clinics posting, that is the facial nerve. And the most common pathology is the Bell's palsy. more so seen in the times with the weather changes during the winter weathers, and also we are seeing it quite often during this COVID-19. So what do you test? You test for the faces for the muscles of facial expression and blinking. You check for the stapedius, but usually it is not tested in an outpatient. But the patient themselves may complain that they hear the sounds very loud, and they put some cotton into the ears because the stapedius muscle, which is supposed to dampen the loud noises, is not functioning. And with that Bell's palsy, their voice is magnified. Any outside noise is magnified. Taste on the anterior 2/3 of the tongue, and tearing, which are parasympathetic supply to the lacrimal glands, and that you can see that the patient continuously has tearing. So this is a classical prototype which has been taken from the net. We can't show a patient's face. You can see that there is no wrinkling of the forehead. There is an inability to close. The eyes is completely open. So if it is not managed well, you can see that the patient would have some corneal ulcerations as well. So it is very important. Either you tape the, and now you put the, ask the patient to put glasses. Inability to puff the cheek. You would see that this nasolabial fold, which is very apparent here, is not apparent in this. There is, if you ask the patient to smile, there is an asymmetry. There is a drooping of the mouth, and the patient cannot swallow. The patient may say that I am not able to swallow, but it's not that the patient is not able to swallow. The patient, the lips cannot be pursed, so the patient is not able to drink, and you need to teach him. So with lower motor neuron lesions, all muscles are affected. With upper motor neuron lesions, you would find only the lower, the part, the forehead and the eyes are not involved. You will find only the nasolabial fold, the chin, and the lower part of the face that is involved. So you can know that whether it is a cortical pathology, that is a stroke, or a Bell's pathology, which is very important because the treatment management would be different in both. So involved in neoplasm, CVA, MND, Bell's palsy, as we said, facial nerve is the most commonly involved. You can see it in myasthenia, bilateral, in GB syndrome, unilateral Bell's, bilateral infections, Lyme's, which is less common, motor neuron disease, late onset, bilateral UMN, multi-infarct states, bilateral lesions, which are affecting the thalamus. The cranial nerve, 8th auditory nerve, they have got two components, the Renes and the Webers, and the auditory and the vestibular, and I'm skipping it because of reasons of time. And we come to the lower cranial nerves, that is the 9th, 10th, and the 12th. The spinal accessory is removed here. You can see that when we were checking the eyes, we did the 3rd, 4th, and the 6th. When we're checking the mouth, we do the 9th, 10th, and the 12th. When we're checking the face, you do the 7th and the 5th. So the glossopharyngeal 9th is the sensory, that is the posterior 1/3 of the tongue, the pharynx, and the middle ear. It has got a motor component, that is the stylopharyngeus, and it has got an autonomic to the salivary gland. The vagus is the sensory to the tympanic, external auditory canal, and the external ear. It has got a motor to the palate, pharynx, and larynx. And autonomics, we all know that there is an afferent from the carotid baroreceptors, parasympathetic supply to and from the thorax and the abdomen. Hypoglossal is 12, there is no sensory, there's only intrinsic muscles of the tongue. So this is the area that we are testing, and what are we testing in that? You are testing, first you are asking the patient to open the mouth and see the position of the uvula. That is, you're checking whether the palate is weak on one side. If the palate is weak on one side, that uvula would be pushed onto that side. Is it central? If you cannot visualize it properly, you are supposed to ask the patient to say ah. Now in COVID-19 times, we have stopped doing this examination. You're looking at the uvula and trying to see whether it is moving at centrally. Does it move over to one side? Next, once you have tested and seen the uvula and the position of the pharynx, then you do the gag. You can take a small ice cream scoop and you can tie it there, or the small with the cotton, but you should take care that the cotton should not fall into this patient's mouth. So gag reflex, what you're trying to do is that you're going to try to touch the posterior pharyngeal wall. Again, it's a brisk and a brief. You just go in and a touch. It will lift following the stimulus. You also need to ask the patient whether he could feel the sensation. If he felt the sensation, then again, the afferent, that is the ninth, is intact. If he, the uvula did not move, that is the posterior pharyngeal wall did not move, that means the efferent, the motor system is not working. So you ask the patient. You ask the patient to, and for the hypoglossal, you are asking the patient to look at the tongue. You can see the tongue here, which is characteristically atrophied. And if one could visualize this tongue, there any rippling movements, that is fasciculation. And you also try to see whether the patient is protruding the tongue, whether it is midline. If the tongue moves on to one side, that means that the opposite side of the tongue is pushing to the paralyzed side. That means if the side which the tongue has got deviated, that side, the hypoglossal nerve is not intact and that is affected because that's the paralyzed side. The powerful muscles are pushing the tongue onto the opposite side. So they could be involved, as we all know, it could be involved in the poliomyelitis, syringobulbia. That is the syrinx, which is the cavitary lesion in the spinal cord, as well as extending into the medulla, or posterior fossa tumor or basal skull. Advanced Parkinson's disease, we can see the patient have got this. Myasthenia, we all know that they have got the lower cranial nerve dysphagia. GB syndromes sometimes, and myasthenia can present with crisis, with the dysphagia and respiratory crisis. Enlarged cervical glands, they could produce, bigger ones could produce compression on the nerves, or as any sort of post-surgical operation procedure can lead to damage to the emerging cranial nerves. The last, which should come out in the neck, as we said, it was a mouth, that is a spinal accessory nerve. It arises from the medulla and has a contribution from spinal root C2 to C4. It is purely motor, as we saw in the first slide. And it innervates the sternocleidomastoid and trapezius. So we need to check two nerves there. So one is an inspection. You're trying to see whether there is any atrophy, wasting, or a hypertrophy. In we see in patients with dystonia, that is movement disorder. And they keep the neck in a dystonic position and the sternocleidomastoid is very prominent. And if there is the head position normal, to see whether the trapezius muscle, you would have heard of the head droop syndrome in patients with motor neuron disease, myasthenia gravis. And in patients with myasthenia gravis, they usually sit in this form because they have a head droop. So they will try to overcome this by just putting a finger here. They have got a jaw drop as well as a neck drop. So they'll keep it that way. So when you test for the extension and the flexion, you will find that the extension is weak. So sternocleidomastoid, ask the patient to lift his head forward, ask the patient to turn his head from side to side. This is the position. You are supposed to keep the hand onto the chin, ask him to push here, ask him to push. Ask the patient to shrug his shoulder. This is the way, both sides, watch for the symmetry, push down the shoulders, and you have checked for the sternocleidomastoid and the trapezius. They're very characteristically involved in motor neuron, polio, GB syndromes, severe strokes, bilateral strokes, and then base of the skull lesions in the form of syringobulbia, myelia, tumors, and trauma at the skull and base of the skull and neck. So this is what we have completed in an hour, and definitely it is not that easy because only the salient points have been brought out. So just to mention some of the salient points of each particular nerve: olfactory, you're checking at the smell. Optic, you're checking at the visual acuity, and the fundus, the oculomotor, you're checking at the eye movements, which is the nuclear as well as the supranuclear. Trigeminal, you're checking at the facial sensation, you're checking at the muscle power, that is masseter and the temporalis, and also you're checking at the corneal reflex. You're checking at the facial, all the muscles. Muscles of the face. Vestibular cochlear, you're checking at the hearing and the balance. Glossopharyngeal, vagus, and the hypoglossal, you are checking at the gag reflex. You're checking at the sensations at the part of the pharynx. And accessory, you are checking at the neck muscles and also the shrugging, that is the shoulder shrug, that is the trapezius. That is easy, small, simplified way so that you do not, if you find that any particular cranial nerve is abnormal, then one might need to go into very detail to see where the lesion is in that way. And that's part of the cranial nerve, and I'm exactly, I think, spot on at 1 hour. And may I take the opportunity to also ask you to scan this QR code there. That is for our stroke prevention campaign, which we are running from our foundation as well as from my Apollo Hospital. That campaign is going to run through all through the year. And this is an awareness drive, because all of us know that 80% of the strokes are preventable. And we want that the general public should know the risk factors, adjust their life and prevent the stroke. Each month would be dedicated to one risk factor. Needless, every month, everybody has to take care of all the risk factors, but we would be trying to focus on one risk factor and bring out the salient points. And we have our stroke prevention campaign page. Kindly do take this opportunity to ask your friends, non-medical people in particular, so that it can reach the maximum and we can reach the goal of the World Stroke Organization to cut stroke into half. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, ma'am, for such an informative session and also for clearing up concepts regarding the causes and even the diagnosis of cranial nerve dysfunction. So, ma'am, we have a few questions. Can we continue with the question and answer session? Okay, ma'am. Ma'am, so the first question we have from the Zoom chat box is, what are the treatment options available to improve vision?
It depends upon what is the etiology. So if the patient has got an optic nerve lesion, that is, if the patient has got an optic neuritis, then if the patient comes in the acute setting, then once we have diagnosed that patient has got an optic neuritis or a retrobulbar neuritis, that is a demyelinating pathology, then the patient gets a course of methylprednisolone, 1 gram for 5 days. And depending upon his further etiological workup, whether he needs to have steroids and further treatment. If the patient has got a vascular lesion, which is leading to the vision defect, let me say an anterior ischemic optic neuritis, then the patient gets blood thinners and the other medications, which helps him to increase the visual power. If the patient says that his vision is not good, then you all also need to know whether the patient has got a retinal pathology, and always need to check if it is a sudden unilateral blindness, whether he has got a central retinal arterial occlusion and he needs to have any intervention done for that matter. Sometimes patient says that they cannot see both eyes, and most of the time they rush to the ophthalmologist. In certain cases, as I mentioned in the last class when we were dealing with the occipital lobe, we said that these patients could be having something which is known as a occipital blindness. So you need to have the patient undergo an imaging to know what is the type. You need to check for the pupils. The pupils are reacting. If the pupils are reacting, the patient is not able to visualize an MRI. And if the patient falls under a window period, then the patient goes under the stroke protocol treatment and a thrombolytic therapy.
Thank you. My question from Zoom is the loss of smell reversible with COVID-19 variants at various stages of the disease?
I do not deal with COVID-19 patients particularly, but many of the, I should say, the outliers, the patients who do come to us, we have seen that as the COVID-19 infection settles, their sense of smell has also come back.
Thank you, ma'am. One more question is, which are the conditions where we observe unequal pupils?
There are several conditions which we have unequal pupils. And in that particular setting, I would like to say, warn that if the patient has got an unequal pupil, then it is a medical emergency. So any any condition which raises the intracranial pressure in the brain. As we know that sixth nerve is the largest nerve and it has got a long course, that could be a false localizing sign and the patient can have a sixth nerve palsy. If the patient has got an aneurysmal PCOM aneurysm and that is compressing on the third nerve, then the patient will have a third nerve palsy on that side and which will not be reacting to light. So any of these cranial nerve abnormality, which is compressive in nature, can produce an unequal pupil. Raised ICT, if the patient has got a stroke and the patient has got a impending damage of a brain death, then initial sign which the patient is noticed, and most of the times it's from the nursing personnel, is an unequal pupil. That is sign of a raised ICT, which needs immediate attention.
Thank you, ma'am. Ma'am, one more question from Zoom is, ma'am, can you please explain about cubital tunnel syndrome and the treatment?
These are all compressive neuropathies and basically they don't come to us. Carpal tunnel and cubital tunnel syndromes are compressive lesions of the medians and ulnar nerves. And you need to find out the etiology. There could be any of these etiology like hypothyroidism, compressive palsies, work-related professional hazards, traumas, any space lesions there, gangliomas. And usually the compressive lesions, if they are more and producing a nerve damage to an extent, they might require surgical intervention, nerve release surgeries.
Thank you, ma'am. One more question is, can migraine does migraine have an effect on optic nerve and can it have long-term effect?
Migraine producing a direct effect on the optic nerve is not known. Patient can present with visual auras in which that patient might see scintillating scotomas. Patient can have lights in front of his black and white or spotted lights, which can look like a visual disturbance for the patient and might look that the patient has got a optic nerve pathology, but migraine and optic nerve pathology is not known. Patient can have complicated migraine in which they can have visual field defects. They can have brainstem pathology in which they can have diplopia. And that might sometimes be misdiagnosed as optic nerve, brainstem pathology, strokes, and various other causes. Long-term pathology of migraine, if he's asking, migraine, if it is not treated properly, can become a chronic migraine and can have effect on the activities of daily living. And can, in women, if migraine is not treated properly, can also be an etiology for strokes in the long run. So should be addressed in the earlier phases itself. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Ma'am, participants has a question from the first session. So, ma'am, can we take that up?
First session was what? The first lecture?
First lecture, yes.
I thought first session means I had divided my session into first and second. Yes, please.
No. Yeah. What is meant by focal and diffuse defects? How can we treat apraxia?
Focal and diffuse defects is if we are saying is focal, let me say is lesion of the third cranial nerve and a sixth cranial nerve, it becomes a focal deficit. If you have only a grip weakness, then it becomes a focal deficit. Diffuse, if you are saying in a form of a hemiplegia or if you have multiple areas involved, he has got a spinal tract involvement, he has got a cranial nerve involvement. Then in anatomical localization, we would say that the patient has got a diffuse involvement of the central as well as the peripheral nervous system, right? If you are meaning from an anatomical limb, then if you want to say that the patient has got only a grip weakness and he has got a focal deficit. Patient presented with a focal deficit in a stroke with only a grip weakness. The patient has got only a focal deficit of a foot drop. The patient has got a meningioma with a focal deficit of only a foot drop. Apraxia needs cognitive training. So it depends upon whether it is a visual agnosia, which type of apraxia the patient has. It got a cognitive training and doesn't have medical treatment per se.
Yes, thank you so much, ma'am. That brings us to the end of the question and answer session. On behalf of the family community, I would like to thank our speaker for today, Dr. Bindu Menon, ma'am, for such an informative and engaging session. Thank you, ma'am, for taking time out of your busy schedule to conduct this lecture. I also want to thank all the participants who have joined us for this session from all over the country. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you very much. Bye-bye.
Hi, ma'am. Thank you so much, ma'am, for taking out time on a Sunday and delivering such an informative web talk, ma'am.
On a Saturday next day. Yeah, thank you.
Yes, ma'am. Sure, ma'am. Thank you so much, ma'am.